In the dead of night, I lift my eyes, I lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I lift my eyes, I lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. Because the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When I cannot see, when I cannot feel your hand in mine, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine your glory, Lord of life, I feel alive in you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive in you. There is strength when I say, reaching for your life. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength, my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Good morning. We're going to have a temple talk, I think, first thing. I was going to say a bazaar talk, but it's a temple talk about the bazaar by Sharon. You wanna... Come on up.
Good morning. You're all awake out there? Well, you might be thinking that this is a little early to be talking about the bazaar, but really it's only 6 weeks away, November 4th. And the reason we're talking a little bit early this year is because we have some changes we want to introduce to you, so you'll kind of be prepared for what's happening. You know, the biggest change over the years is the size of the bazaar. Many of you will remember that the bazaar started out back just in the small, what's now the small fellowship hall, but as you know, it has grown and grown and grown to encompass all the large rooms in the church. So that means over the years, the need for more help has grown, and that hasn't changed today. We do need a lot of help, and this used to be, well, it is sponsored by WISC, the Women in Service for Christ, but it really has become a church-wide event. So that means we need everybody, not just the women, but the men, the young people. We need all of you to make this happen. And because there's some changes coming, I'm going to have Sharon speak here.
Well, the Candy Cane Cafe will still be in the same place. We will serve the same menu for the same price. And you can't beat that because prices of food have gone up a lot. What is changed is how we're going to purchase some of the food. If you purchase vegetables or perishable items, I'm going to be the designated shopper and order that from suppliers and in quantity, hoping to do a better pricing and make it a little more convenient for you. But to do this, to be a designated shopper, you have to have the dollars. So when you come in a week or two to sign up at the tables out there, I'll have a canister for money to do the shopping for the vegetables and the perishables for the kitchen. We need help to sign up. We have made the time slots shorter. That doesn't mean you can't work the same time and just sign for two, but if you have only an hour or so to give, we can still use that amount of time to make a slot a little more easy to do. So if you have any questions, we have our phone numbers in the papers that were passed out. We'll have the sheets for you to look over and read them over and think of what you can do, or if you have a question, you'll have time to answer it before that time. But there's nothing more satisfying as working that day and walking out of here and it's successful and knowing every dollar or everything you did is going to help someone. And that's hard to, you know, to outdo. That's a very worthwhile project. So please keep that in mind. Thank you.
And I have just a couple other changes that are going to happen. First of all, we're only going to decorate on, actually we're going to decorate on 2 days. We used to decorate on three or four. We're going to do all the decorating on Monday, starting in the morning, going till late afternoon. You can come anytime you want. That'll be the gym, the gathering room, and hallway. We do all that. In one day, we're going to get it done. And what's done is done. And then on Friday, if you can come on Friday, that'll be helping Sharon decorate the kitchen. That'll be the last thing to do. On Tuesday, we'll be cutting the vegetables that Sharon's going to buy. So bring your favorite knife or chopping tool, and that'll be in the morning. Then on Saturday, we are going to have hostesses that are going to be passing out a list, the menu list, with check marks. So you people who are coming to eat can check off what they want ahead of time, think about it, and then they'll be able to hand that paper to the person who's working in the kitchen through the window. So that hopefully will speed up things a little bit there. And all these changes have come from suggestions that were made last year by some of you and also some of our guests. So if you check this handout, like Sharon said, it tells you all the things. We'll be talking more about some of the specifics on October 15th and the 22nd when we'll be doing the sign-up. We're hoping to do that in 2 days this year and get that done in 2 days. So if you look on the back, it does tell you all the things that we will need donated and all the things that you can do to help. I told First Service, if you're not going to be here, you know ahead of time you're not going to be here, and you want to sign up for something specific, you can call or text me, because I'll have the master list. Don't call the office, because the office won't have the master list. So mark the date, November 4th. Oh, I forgot, one other thing, cleanup. Many of you have done cleanup before. The cleanup will be at 3:30 instead of 3. We're trying to give the crafters a little time to get out of here and get their stuff all packed up and gone. We hope that'll make it a little easier for everybody. So November 4th, remember that, like Sharon said, every dollar you spend, every hour you work will benefit someone who gets the proceeds from this event. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Sharon and Sharon. Won't you stand if you can and greet those around you. Those are others that are seeking after God just like you are.
I barely heard two of them in my ears. It's like someone said more than me.
Well, good morning. You know how you made a choice to come to church, right? You had to do something. And it's always a good thing. When we get here, it's all, you're always glad you're here, right? And so we're going to sing, and we should make, always make the choice to rejoice. And Lord, start a fire in our souls.
Chosen, rainbow sons.
That you have for us that we can't even comprehend, that you give your life for us, for your love for us. Lord, teach us to be lights to one another, to encourage one another, to love and good works, and to be a part of this community and be strong and love the brethren and love you. And we thank you for your presence in this place today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You can be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. Good to have you all with us here today. I'm Pastor Gibbs. Most of you know that, but there might be a few who don't. A special welcome to those joining us on the stream as well this morning. Love that last song. That last song makes me want to cry every time we sing it, when it just speaks of how deep God's love is for each of us. It's just an amazing thing. All right, today we're going to continue our readings in the Gospel of Matthew. We're going to hear Jesus tell a rather long story today. So I hope you'll bear with me here as I work my way through these 16 verses. So Jesus says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, 'You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. He asked them, 'Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?' 'Because no one has hired us,' they answered. He said to them," this is the landowner saying to the people standing there at 5 p.m., "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came and each received a denarius. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. In fact, they had worked 12 hours where the others had only worked 1 hour, so they probably expected to get 12 denarius, didn't they? But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. These who were hired last worked only 1 hour, they said. And you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the burden of the work and the heat of the day. But he, the landowner, answered one of them, I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? The literal translation of that last question is, or is your evil eye looking upon me because I'm good? I like that term, your evil eye. So the last will be first, and the first shall be last. This is the gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. The title of my message today is The Amazing, Surprising, Shocking Kingdom. We are all obsessed with fairness today. And when I say we, I mean our culture and our society, of which we are a part. It's not a new obsession, really. We've worried about getting our fair share at least since Cain killed Abel. And you remember why Cain killed Abel, right? Because Abel's offering before God was favored more than Cain's, and Cain just didn't think that was fair. You can't turn on the TV or social media today without seeing people attacking other people over the lack of fairness. Like I said, it's just become a total obsession. The pursuit of fairness has become the ultimate virtue in our world today, our newest, greatest idol. And so we find stories like our gospel lesson today difficult to stomach, don't we? As it depicts a God who cares little, if anything at all, about fairness. Today's gospel tells us about a God who doesn't give us what we deserve, but who delights in giving us what we don't deserve. What do we deserve? We deserve death, don't we? Because the scriptures are clear, the wages of sin is death. And we really don't deserve the kingdom of God, do we? Because we have practiced this culture of sin and death. And yet God has made a way through the cross and sacrifice of Jesus Christ. He's made a way to bestow upon us his heavenly kingdom, even though we don't deserve it one bit. The story also points out another related fact. We like God's grace, don't we? We just love God's grace when it's shown to us. But we get really annoyed when God doesn't lower the boom on others whom we think deserve to have the boom lowered on them. What's that all about? Well, it's about the difference between the world's values and kingdom values, okay? It's the difference between the theology of the world and the theology of the kingdom. In the kingdom of the world, we think we have to earn everything, don't we? I mean, that's how the world is organized. And we spend our lives striving for more money, striving for more power, striving for more respect in our society, striving for more fairness. And that's all we think about, isn't it? We think about, you know, earning what we deserve and receiving what we deserve. And we get really irritated when we see other people who seem to be receiving things that they haven't earned it. They don't deserve it, right? But those are worldly values. And what this story tells us today is that the kingdom is not organized in accordance with those values. So I want you to hold on tight. Because God is just about to disabuse us thoroughly of the notion that we need to earn the kingdom of God. So let's look at the kingdom. What is the kingdom? Well, as I mentioned in my sermon title, it's the amazing, surprising, shocking kingdom. Well, what's so amazing about it? Let's spend a few minutes reviewing each of these categories here. What's so amazing about the kingdom? Well, Matthew's been telling us all along all of these just amazing stories about the kingdom. Think of some of these stories we've heard here in our readings from Matthew. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. Have you ever held a mustard seed in your hand? I mean, if you breathe on it, it blows away. It's so small and so light. I mean, it's like the size of a pinprick. And yet you plant that, and eventually it grows into this great big bush. It's an amazing thing to see. It's wonderful. And we don't know how that happens. So the growth of this mustard bush is not just amazing from the standpoint of the growth, but also the mystery. How does it do that? How does it get so big? Jesus says it grows so big that birds come and make their nests in it. That's a big bush right there. And Jesus says the kingdom's like that. Well, how do mustard seeds get planted in the kingdom? Spiritual mustard seeds get planted anytime a believer proclaims the gospel to another person. When you go up to a person and say, I just want you to know God loves you and I'm praying for you. You know, God wants you to turn to him and live. God wants to forgive you. Just turn to him and ask. When that kind of conversation takes place, that's planting of the mustard seeds. And guess what happens when that when those things occur? Great things. We should expect great things to happen, just like the mustard seed growing into this great big bush. And we see it all around us. Sometimes I think we see it, but we don't recognize it. We kind of don't think about it. Take this church, for instance. You know, a few people way back in 1867 planted a few mustard seeds here in Whiteford Township. And what happened? A big church grew up, and that church has been doing ministry, been proclaiming the gospel, been ministering to the people of the world from this spot for 157 years. That's pretty amazing, don't you think? And you all get to be a part of that. Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is like a sower who goes out to sow. And what does he do? He spreads the seed on everything. It gets everywhere. Sidewalk, you know, hard path, out in the weeds, you know. What farmer in his right mind is going to go out and sow seed in his weed field, right? And if you got a field that's full of weeds, you're not going to go out there and sow weeds in it, right? At least not with some significant soil preparation, right? But he spreads it everywhere. Some of it grows up, does well. A lot of it doesn't, you know. Kingdom of heaven's like that, right? What has the church been doing for 2,000 years? We've been spreading the word, the seed of the word, the spiritual seed of the word on everybody. That's what we do. And guess what? All of that seed sprouts up. Some of it, you know, gets choked out by weeds. Some of it gets burned away by the sun. Some of it gets eaten by the birds. But there's some good seed that grows up. And what did Jesus say happens when that occurs? He said that good seed will produce 30 or 60 or 90 times as much. Not, you know, the biblical word is 30 or 60 or 90 fold. That's how much it will produce. That's mysterious, isn't it? Isn't that mysterious that happens? But it does. I mean, think of all of the fruit that's just produced in this one little congregation here at the corner of Temperance and Whiteford Road. It's an amazing thing. So God plants his word You know, God planted his word in you. He planted his word in me. And we've been bearing fruit ever since. And God has been growing us up into the people that he wants us to be. And you know what? He's doing that for a reason, because he wants to give us the kingdom. Well, what is this kingdom? Well, Jesus told us a few more stories. He said, the kingdom is like a pearl of great price that's hidden in a marketplace. And when a woman finds that pearl, you know what she does? She runs home and she sells everything, everything that she owns, so that she can go buy that pearl of great price, because she knows its value. She knows it's the most valuable thing in all of the world. Then he says, there was a man, he was out plowing in his neighbor's field, and he ran into something with his plow, and he got down and he dug around it, and he found a buried treasure. And I mean, it wasn't any just like run-of-the-mill buried treasure. It was the greatest buried treasure ever. And when he saw that, you know what he did? He covered it back up. I assume he marked it with a rock or something, right? He didn't put a sign on that says, buried treasure right here, I'm sure, but probably a rock or something. Then he runs home, and what does he do? He sells everything, everything that he has, because he knows the value of that treasure. And he goes and buys that treasure, he buys that field. He doesn't just buy the treasure. He buys the field so he can have the treasure. What Jesus is saying to you is the kingdom of God, living in relationship with Jesus Christ, in an intimate, saving relationship with Jesus Christ and the body of Christ represented by the church, is the most valuable thing that you can ever obtain. And it's worth every effort that you can make to get yourself on board with the kingdom of God, to get yourself, connected to, attached to the kingdom of God. It's the one thing, not just of great value, but of infinite value. Infinite value. So it's an amazing kingdom. But it's also a surprising kingdom. Well, what's surprising about it? Well, did you see that last verse that I read at the end of our scripture lesson this morning? Jesus says, oh, by the way, just so you know, in the kingdom of God, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Well, what's up with that? That sure flies in the face of the world's values, isn't it? Last night when Notre Dame got beat, did you notice that none of them were running on the field saying, the first shall be last, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. We're going to be first because we were last today. They're not going to say that. That's not the world's value. And the world's values are the first shall be first, and the first get to tell the last what to do. Right? That's the world's values. But Jesus says, that's not the way it is in the kingdom. In the kingdom, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Well, what's up with that? He goes on to even say that the least shall be greatest, and the greatest shall be least, and the servant shall reign, and the master shall serve. Aren't too many places where that happens in the world, is it? It's a kingdom of reversal. In the kingdom of God, God turns the world's values upside down. And why is that? Because the world's values were developed by the evil one. He's the one that promoted, you know, this idea that you have to work by the sweat of your brow. You know, you can't depend on anybody. You know, your purpose in life is to get to the top no matter who you step over. That's Satan created that way of thinking. But that's not the way it works in the kingdom of God. What does Jesus go on to say in Matthew's gospel? Jesus says, you know, if you want to receive the kingdom of God, you have to do so like a little child. Well, how does a little child receive the kingdom? He doesn't go out and earn it. He comes to Sunday school, and a Sunday school teacher says to him, God loves you, and he wants you to be his disciple. And the little child says, awesome. Sign me up. That's faith. That's the faith of a little child That's what God expects. And then, you know, Jesus says, to such as these, to these little children, belongs the kingdom. And then he goes on to say, you know, Sean talked about this last week in his sermon. He goes on to say that kingdom people are people with open hands. That is, people who let go of sin. If your brother or sister sins against you, you are encouraged to do what? To forgive them. Forgiveness is opening your hands and letting go of the sin that your brother or sister has worked against you. We don't hold grudges in the kingdom. If you're holding a grudge right now, you're on the edge of the kingdom. Right? If you got grudges in your heart right now, open your hands. Let go of them so you can get to the center of the kingdom. Man, that's where you want to be. That's where Jesus is. That's where the joy is of the kingdom. Let go. Let go of your grudges. Well, Peter was willing to let go of his grudges up to 7 times against the same person. Sean was talking last week about how in the law of Moses and in the rabbinical interpretations of the law of Moses that you were required to forgive your brother 3 times. And if he sinned against you a 4th time, man, you know, too bad, right? So Peter says, well, you know, Jesus is talking about grace, and I want him to think I'm a gracious guy. So I'm going to tell Jesus I'm not going to forgive my brother 3 times. I'm going to forgive my brother 7 times. One more than twice what the law requires. That certainly has to make me a gracious person, right? But Jesus says, no, Peter, you don't get it. Not just 7 times, but 7 times, 70 times, 490 times you have to forgive your brother. That, of course, is a euphemism, right? For you have to forgive your brother every single time that he sins against you. No matter how many times it is. Because that's a kingdom value. In the kingdom, the currency that pays is forgiveness. Everybody's forgiven everybody. Everybody's given forgiveness and everybody's receiving forgiveness. Why is that? Why do you think we do that? Well, it's because forgiveness is the grease that lubes the wheels of community. I mean, you look out at our world today, and everyone's miserable, aren't they? Everyone is standing up demanding their fair share of the pie, all right? Or if somebody's coming to them and saying, you have too much of the pie, what are we doing? We're getting defensive and just standing back and saying, uh-uh, no, you know. That's not true. You're not telling me the truth. And so we're all at each other's throats. Remember the last week in the story, you know, when Sean read about the one guy that was forgiven by the king. The king forgave him like 200,000 years wages or whatever. As soon as he left, he went out and he saw a guy that owed him like, you know, $50, and he grabbed him by the throat. And that's what we all do, isn't it? We grab everybody by the throat, and we're just shaking each other, and it ain't fun. We're all miserable. Okay? Why is that? Because we're practicing the values of the world. Okay? We all want what we think is fair. You know, well, you know what? In the kingdom of God, if you got what was fair, you would get death, because the wages of sin is death. That's the shocking thing about the kingdom, isn't it? The shocking thing about the kingdom is that we don't earn it. Okay? Membership in the kingdom of God is not earned. Membership in the kingdom of God is by divine invitation only. If you want to get into the kingdom of God, you have to be invited in by God Himself. We saw that, you know, in our story here today, right? What did the landowner do who needed to have workers in his vineyard? He went out to the marketplace, and he invited people in. He called them. He ordered them in. Did you see that? You know, the guys, the 5 o'clock guys, they're standing there. Why aren't you working? Well, because nobody said that we could go work, that no one hired us. And he goes, get in there right now. Go work. He ordered them to go work in his kingdom. They were elected. They were elected by God. And each of you has been elected by God to serve in his kingdom. And I know that's true. Those of you who are sitting here who are baptized, you've been elected. That's what baptism is all about. God is calling you in his kingdom. If you're sitting here and someone has said to you, God loves you. God wants to have a saving relationship with you. Turn to him and live. And you did? You've been elected. That person came to you with the authority of God to call you into the kingdom. He had God's authority to call you into the kingdom. So none of us earn it, right? None of us, those workers there in the marketplace, you can bet they were the lowest of the low. They were the dregs of employees. They had no skills except, you know, they had hands they could pick things with. The guy hired them anyway, brought them in. They didn't earn it. And you'll note the landowner elected every single person that he saw. He invited, he called every single person he saw in the marketplace. And that rubs us the wrong way, doesn't it? It rubs us the wrong way to think that latecomers, you know, those people who have deathbed conversions, scoundrels, you know, oh, there's so many people out there that are so worse than I am, you know, and yet God is going to call them and they're going to turn to God and they're going to get in the kingdom. And that rubs us the wrong way when we think that way. Why is that? Because we're thinking with worldly values. We're thinking that somehow, some way, the fact that I'm a little more shiny than the next guy, or that I've been a little more generous, I've been a little more kind than the next guy, is going to get me in the kingdom. It's going to somehow help me get in the kingdom. And these other people, they don't deserve it, you know. But what did Isaiah say? Isaiah said, chapter 59, our righteousness before God is like filthy rags. Sin is the great equalizer. Sin just equalizes us all. It makes us all need God's grace. In the vineyard story, you will note that those who came late in the day, they received the same wage as those who worked all day. And again, that rubs us the wrong way, right? We go, oh, how unfair. How unfair is that, right? How unfair that the guys who worked an hour got a denarius and the guys who worked 12 hours got a denarius. That's so unfair, we say. But you know, there's something else at work here, something really, really important. And if you don't pay close attention to the story, you'll miss it. The denarius stood for a day's wage, okay? It was just like the standard day's wage for a day laborer, okay? What it really meant is this. It was the minimum wage a person needed to feed his family for one day. That's what a denarius was. Wow, that makes that denarius a whole lot more important, doesn't it? If you're a day laborer standing out there in the marketplace and you're dependent on today's job to feed your family tomorrow, what happens if you don't get called to do a job? The next day, your family goes hungry. Do too many of those days in a row and your family starves, right? So those guys that were standing there at 5 o'clock, they were probably pretty nervous, pretty anxious. Oh my gosh, I'm not going to have any money to take home to my family to buy food for tomorrow. Had the workers who worked for only one of the 12 hours of the day only received 1/12 of a denarius, you know, the wage based on fairness, they and their families would have gone hungry the next day. And so this landowner is really being gracious, isn't he? By giving them a denarius, he's making sure that this worker can protect his family for the next day. It's a divine currency, isn't it? That's what God desires. He desires that we all get what we need, not what we think is fair, not what we deserve. He wants us to get what we need. In the divine economy of heaven, we all need eternal life. God graciously grants it to all who come to work in His divine vineyard, regardless of when they come or their worthiness to receive such an honor. You know, in our story today, the guy standing around at 5 p.m., they're most likely, like I said, the worst workers, and yet the vineyard owner calls them anyway and pays them a day's wage because he wants them to get what they need. He's concerned about their welfare. The same is true with God. You know, God created all of us. He created all of us who think we're so wonderful. He created all of the people out there who are latecomers. You know, all of you who come into church 15 minutes late, He created even you. He created the scoundrels of the world. And He loves us all. And He desires all of us to turn from our sin and live, regardless of how much sinfulness we've piled up. That's kingdom economics right there, folks. God desires that we all receive what we need. And what we need is Jesus. What we need is eternal life. And God never tires of giving it. So, at the bottom of your page, your sermon notes page, you'll notice there's a faith challenge there. And here's the faith challenge. The faith challenge is to live as if God is truly sovereign. To live as if God is truly in control and gets to decide who gets in and who's not in the kingdom. That's God's business. That's not your business. How dare we sit around and look at other people and go, man, look how bad of sinners they are. I'll bet they're not going to make it into the kingdom. Hey, man, that's not your business. Your business is to proclaim the gospel. Your business is to get out there and to be God's mouthpiece in the world and let the world know that God loves everyone and desires that everyone turn to Him and live. In other words, allow God to be God in your life, however He chooses, even if it runs, this is really important, even if it runs counter to your own sensibilities and your own intuitions. I'm going to close with that verse I have there at the bottom, Isaiah 55, 5 to 7. And I'm going to put this in the first person plural because it's when Isaiah is speaking God's word here and saying them, he really means us. Because you know what? We're all scoundrels. We're all latecomers to the party. Luther said it this way. He said, we're all beggars. When it comes to salvation, when it comes to eternal life, we're all beggars. We all depend on the mercy of God. So seek the Lord while He may be found. Call on Him while He is near. Let we, the wicked, forsake our ways, and let we, the unrighteous, forsake our thoughts. Let us turn to the Lord, and He will have mercy on us. Let us turn to our God, for He will freely pardon. We serve such an awesome God. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let me first ask, are there any joys that you'd like to share today? Yes. Okay, Ethan Lykowski, happy birthday. Anyone else have a joy this morning? You Ohio State fans are being awful humble here today. All right, a couple additions to our prayer list. Today is Lynn Kutsky's anniversary of his death. He died 1 year ago today. The extra flowers up here are from his family, so we want to remember Lynn and his family today. Lenny was such a great saint around here, loved having him around, really miss him. But we rejoice that he's in heaven with Jesus today. Been there for a year singing praises. And you know what? He's been there a year, but his eternity has just begun. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. Also, we want to pray for the Allen family, John and Alex Allen, part of the Schmidlin clan. John's father passed away today, so we want to pray for him and his family. Anyone else we should pray for? Yes, Denise.
Dallas.
For who?
Dallas.
He's
a
young man in his 20s. Okay. We'll pray for Dallas, friend of Denise, having surgery. Anyone else? Yes.
Phronsie.
Pray for Phronsie. Friend of Judy Governo. Okay. Anyone else? Yeah. Harlan. For who?
Russ.
We'll pray for Russ. Others? All right, let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, gracious Lord, we thank you for this word of grace we hear this morning. We thank you that you call your people into your divine heavenly vineyard kingdom, where we serve as your disciples, where the first are last and the last are first, the greatest are least and the least are greatest, where the servant reigns supreme. As our Lord said, you know, if you want to be greatest in the kingdom, you must become a servant of all. So we thank you for that kingdom ethic, because it lifts us out of all the messiness of seeking fairness. All of that pain and anxiety that comes with not knowing if you've received your fair share. We don't have to worry about that anymore. We know we've received beyond our fair share. We've received what we need. We've received Jesus. We've received eternal life, the promise of eternal life. We've received a calling, a purpose. And we are just overjoyed in that. So we thank and praise you, Lord, for this kingdom that you've given us through your Son and his sacrifice on the cross. We just ask and pray now, Lord, that in your wisdom, through your Holy Spirit, and through the power that the Spirit brings, that we would be able to live as kingdom people, that we would be modelers of the kingdom, that we would indeed become servants, that we would be a forgiving people, a people who receive the kingdom as little children receive Jesus. We thank you, we praise you, Father, for allowing us to participate in this great work of yours, of reconciling the world to yourself. Send us forth, make it clear to us in our minds what our marching orders are, and inspire us to serve you with every fiber of our being. That is our prayer today, Lord God. So come. Hear our prayers for these people that we just lifted up to you, the Allen family, the family of Lynn Kutsky. Both continue to mourn, and yet they have the hope of Jesus Christ. We do not grieve as the world grieves, for we know that death is not the end, but the beginning of eternal life in the kingdom. We pray for Dallas as he undergoes surgery. We pray for Phronsie and for Russ. Whatever their need is, Lord, we pray that you would provide it for them. Hear the prayers that we lift up in the silence of our hearts. Lord, receive our prayers for those on our prayer list. Bring your healing power to bear in the lives of your people. So, Lord, we praise you. We honor you. We're so grateful, so filled with joy at the privilege of being counted as members of the kingdom of God. We're so thankful that you called us into this kingdom. We're so thankful that you've given us faith to turn from our evil ways and to walk in the righteousness of the kingdom. Lord, keep us humble. Keep us focused. Help us to keep our eyes on Jesus as we go forward into the future. And help us to just trust you're going to do whatever is best for us. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Ushers, would you come forward and receive the offering, please? The only announcement I have is that I hope you will all stay, if you're able, for the special congregational meeting that's going to take place immediately following this service. We are going to be looking at the recommendations of the leadership transition team. It's an important task that the church has to take on with my impending retirement, as we plan together to continue the mission of this church. So stay if you can. All right, I'll turn it over to the worship team.
Okay, thanks. Stand if you can. Let's do one more song. Worship is about, you know, putting our focus on the things of God and His Word. And this is just a fun song. Some were here early. They kind of learned it, so maybe they helped me sing it. But these are the names of God. As we go through and think of those names of who God is, He is everything. He is all in all. These are the names of God.
These are the names of God.
good shepherd. These are the names of God. It is Jesus, precious Jesus, Lord and Savior. These are the names of God, our God. Amen. Could say go in peace, but we're going to stay in peace and have a meeting, right?
Thanks be to God.